Ready? Salivary glands. So all we care about is up here. There's only three. Parotid. Para means next to, and otic means ear. So parotid salivary gland is this big one here. If we look inside from the other direction now, under the tongue, I said think tongue, think lingual. So this could be your sublingual salivary gland here. And then if we go back to the outside, there's going to be one hiding up under your mandible. Under the mandible would be submandibular salivary gland there. So parotid, submandibular, sublingual. That's this one. So let's look at a different model. So this one, even though we don't have a face on it, believe it or not, we can still see two of them. We can see the sublingual salivary gland here under the tongue, and the submandibular salivary gland here hanging out on the bottom. And then on this flat one, again, parotid salivary gland near the ear, sublingual underneath the tongue, and submandibular down here. That's it. All right, so we've already talked about all these structures up top, so we're moving down now. Once we get to here, this is the esophagus coming down clearly. So the esophagus is here, and when it ends, right here before it joins the stomach, there's actually a ring of muscles, and it's called the lower esophageal sphincter. So the lower esophageal sphincter is here. The other two parts you need to see under the esophagus on your list, you need to see actually on a torso. So the esophageal hiatus, so if we look here at the torso, under A, look here at the torso, this is your esophagus coming down in the yellow, not this white stuff that's wrapped around it, but the actual yellow tube is your esophagus. And you can see it pops through this muscle sheet, which is the diaphragm, and it makes a little hole. And that hole has a name, it's called the esophageal hiatus. So the hole where the diaphragm punctures, or the esophagus punctures the diaphragm, is your esophageal hiatus. Obviously this is the diaphragm itself. So that's it, and then I wanted to show you on this one too, this is scary, from the other torso. This sits in the other torso, it's in the room that we just didn't drag out. So just so you guys realize, there's the hole the esophagus comes through, right? Comes down in, that's called the esophageal hiatus. It might actually be this hole, not sure. One of the holes, I'm not sure how it sits over there because I don't ever play with that model. Esophageal hiatus, this is your diaphragm, this creepy looking thing here. So it should be fine. All right, moving into the stomach. Okay, so now we're gonna move into the stomach. So we're gonna start on the board first. There's a bunch of parts of the stomach you need to know. You can't see this, the actual layers of muscle on the flat boards. The only one you can see it on is gonna be this one. So if we look at this stomach, you can see that there's a couple of layers of muscles. So what are the muscle layers, basically? Well, if you look carefully at the model, this is the most superficial layer. The next layer down is this one, and then the deepest layer is gonna be this one. So the most superficial one is labeled 401, the middle one is 402, and the deepest one is 403. So which one is which? This deepest one here is gonna be what we call the oblique muscle layer. So this is your oblique muscle layer here. The one that wraps around, like encircling the stomach, is gonna be the circular layer here. And then the outermost one is gonna be the longitudinal layer that's out here. So it goes longitudinal, circular, oblique. Those are your muscle layers in your stomach wall. Moving along. So now we have some curves. So these are really, really easy. The stomach, as you can see, has a big curve on the outside and then has a smaller curve on the inside. This is called the greater curvature of the stomach. This is the lesser curvature of the stomach. So on this one, same thing. Greater curvature of the stomach, lesser curvature of the stomach. And then the other stomach we have, greater curvature of the stomach, lesser curvature of the stomach. That's good. You have some omentums, which we don't have any models of, so I'm not sure where you'd see those except for on a dissection. So there's a greater omentum, which would hang off of the greater curvature, and there's a lesser omentum that would actually connect the stomach to the liver. So it'd be a little piece of, basically looks like fat, it's like a yellowy tissue that connects these two guys together. What else we got? So we got some portions. So the first little chunk of your stomach that kind of is near where your esophagus joins is called the cardiac portion of the stomach. So we can see it here. If we open this guy up, if he even opens, cardiac portion would be right around here. And the same thing here, maybe this darker colored pink region would be the cardiac portion of your stomach on this one. After that, we got some other regions. We got a fundus. So the fundus is this upper dome shaped part of the stomach. So basically not the little cardiac region, but just this upper dome part here, the upper dome part right here, and then the upper dome part right here, fundus. The body is going to be the majority of the stomach, so all this region here, basically from the fundus coming all the way down, this whole space is going to be body. And once it starts to get narrow again, we're going to call it the pyloric portion. So this is going to be your pyloric portion here. So just remember, cardiac portion, fundus, body, pyloric region is going to be over here. And then this one, same thing. Cardiac region, fundus, body, pyloric region's over here. After that, we have a pyloric sphincter. So you can see here where it starts to get really narrow. This is a muscle ring that can actually close off so that the food doesn't just fly through your stomach into your small intestine. So this is going to be your pyloric sphincter right here, shown on this one. Pyloric sphincter, I think they're labeling 409 on this one. And then this one, you can see where it pinches. Pyloric sphincter right here. Right. Other than that, inside of your stomach you have all these lovely folds. The folds are called rugae, so all these little rugae are the folds. This one again, rugae for folds. And that's it for the stomach. Right, basically right here, and then I'm gonna show it on the other two versions of the intestines we have.
Go ahead.
All right, ready? So now we're gonna do the small intestine. So the first thing I'm gonna do is actually gonna take off a chunk of the large intestine so you can see the small intestine. So I'm pulling off large intestine. So you can see here, the stomach comes down, we go through the pyloric sphincter here. Now we've entered the small intestine. The first part of the small intestine is called the duodenum. It's basically the first 10 inches of the small intestine. So this whole little region here coming up and around is gonna be your duodenum. If you see here, this is the pancreas, this kind of blobby shaped thing with the big long stripe in the middle of it. There's a little nub right in the center where basically the pancreas and also the liver dump their fluids that they make into the small intestine. That little nub is called the duodenal papillae, or the papilla, so duodenal papilla here. After you go through the first 10 inches of the lovely small intestine, you move into the second section of the small intestine, which you probably label near the number. This is going to be your jejunum, so it's the next chunk of the small intestine. And then the very last chunk here, you can see at the very end, it kind of wraps around and it comes up and it has a little pinched off region. This is going to be your ileum. And at the very, very end, you can see this little squished up region. It's a muscle ring, shockingly enough, it's a sphincter. It's going to be your ileocecal valve. So ileocecal valve, because it goes from the ileum to the cecum, which is the first part of the large intestine. So just remember, the ileum is the last part of the small, the cecum is the first part of the large, ileocecal valve is going to be here. That's it. Okay, oh, now I want to show you on these ones too. Okay. So same story, but just a little bit, it looks a little bit different depending on which section of intestines you're looking at. So this is from one of the torsos, and then this one up here is actually from a second torso in the back of the room. So I just want to show you on both of these as well. So if you look here, this is going to be, in the gray is your large intestine. So I'm actually going to pull the small intestines out of the large intestines. And you can see here where the small intestines first start. This would be your duodenum coming up around 432, I guess. And then the next section would be the jejunum here. And then the last section over here would be your ileum. And if you look at the back, you can see where the ileum ends. This would be the ileocecal valve at the very, very end. You can also see it over here where it feeds into the cecum, the first part of the large intestine, the ileocecal valve. So that's the intestines from one of the torsos, and then this again is just from the other torso. So in the brown is the large intestine, this is the small intestine. If we pull them apart, again you can see where the duodenum starts. So this first chunk is going to be the duodenum, basically. You can't really see the papillae, you can see the other one though. So the duodenum is here. Usually they'll throw maybe it's towards the center where it's 48. This would be your jejunum here, and then at the very, very end, you can see the end of the tube if you follow it back. This would be the ileum down here. So at the very end would be your ileocecal valve. Again, you can see the ileum's coming around. It's joining up with the cecum. This would be your ileocecal valve here on this torso, or particular model. That's it for small intestine. So now we're going to go to the pathology. All right, here we go. So this is actually, believe it or not, this is not upside down ice cream cones. It's not, what else do we think? It was a tongue. This is actually the wall of the small intestine. So if we look, zoomed in on the wall of the small intestine, this is what we would see. So if we look, the first layer of cells are going to be your epithelial cells. So these little kind of square shaped cells that line these little villi are going to be epithelial cells. In the center, you have a little yellow tube called the lacteal that picks up fats that you're absorbing from your food. The next layer down, this little red layer here, is going to be your muscularis mucosa. So this is your muscularis mucosa layer here. The next layer, this kind of peachy color, is going to be your submucosa right here. And then the thicker layer of muscle is going to be your muscularis externa muscles down here. So it's going to be this nice big layer down here. Inside, if you actually look at this little epithelial tissue and you zoom in, this is supposed to be a magnifying glass, not a big circle. So if we zoom in on this little cell, this is what it would look like. This is basically this crypt. You can see these little yellow, or not yellow, little white dots. These are called goblet cells. They're going to make a bunch of mucus. Inside here, we also have these little red dots. These are called Paneth cells. So Paneth cells are going to be these little red dots. If we look on the outside of that, now going back out to the layers, Orbox plexus is going to be these little light blue, white colored dots out here. This is Orbox plexus here. And then Messner's plexus is going to be the ones that are in the submucosal layer up here, so a little bit higher. So just remember, Orbox are in the muscularis externa layer, whereas the Messner's is going to be in the submucosal layer. And that's it for this guy. Yeah. All right, so now we're going to do the digestive system part one for the second exam. Obviously, all this blue crap is not supposed to be there. It's just a vein exploded, a big one, and it just kind of put dye everywhere. Note to self. All right, so we're going to start at the beginning. So just to get the trachea out of the way, this again is the esophagus. We can actually follow the esophagus down, 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 down. And if we look under here, this is our esophagus here. So it's still esophagus here. And you can see, this is the diaphragm, this sheet of muscle. There's a hole in the diaphragm. where the esophagus is going through and coming out the other side, which we might be able to see, hopefully. Yep. So this is our esophagus coming out. This is the stomach. So the esophagus is here coming out the other side of the lovely diaphragm. So this hole, pop a hole in this thing and get it, there we go. So this hole that the esophagus is coming through is the esophageal hiatus. So esophageal hiatus, esophagus. Here we are at the stomach. So as we're moving into the stomach, there's a whole bunch of parts you need to know on our lovely stomach. The first part of the stomach where it attaches to the esophagus, so this little region right here of the stomach, is going to be your cardiac portion of your stomach. This upper dome shape is going to be the fundus. The majority of the stomach is going to be the body. When it gets narrow over here, it's the pyloric portion or pyloric part. Portion you have down here. Where it gets really narrow and tightens up right here, you can see where it looks like there's like a piece of invisible string kind of wrapped around. That's going to be your pyloric sphincter. And if we actually open it up and look from the inside, you can see right there, there's a little hole. Pyloric sphincter. Okay. We have the greater curvature of the stomach. So the greater curvature is this outer curvature, and it has all this fun, well, it's not supposed to be blue, it's supposed to be yellow, fatty material. This is called your greater omentum that I'm squeezing. All this is greater omentum coming off the greater curvature of the stomach. You have a lesser omentum, again, this blue, which is not supposed to be blue, it's supposed to be yellow on the inside, in the lesser curvature of the stomach. Moving along past the stomach, so the first section of the small intestine, so it's going to be this section here, is going to be your duodenum. If you guys kind of go a little bit further along in the intestines, go towards maybe like the middle, we're just going to call this middle part jejunum. And then when we get to the end, because this is obviously a larger tube, we get to the end, this last little region of small intestine is going to be the ileum. So this is ileum. You can see it's not the same thing as a large intestine because it's a lot smaller in diameter. See the size difference? Large intestine, last little section of small intestine. So this is ileum. And at the very, very end where the ileum butts up to the first part of the large intestine, you have the ileocecal valve. Again, you can see where it gets really, really tight right in here, ileocecal valve. And if I open it up and look at the inside of it, again, you can see a little muscle ring right here. It's got some crap in it, but that's okay. That's going to be your ileocecal valve right there. So ileocecal valve is between the ileum and the first part of the large intestine, the cecum. That's it.
Yeah, go ahead.
All right, guys, so this is going to be for the exam number 3, digestive system part 2. Exam number 3, digestive system part 2, in case we edit that out. So again, this cat is not supposed to be exploded blue just because a blood vessel blew up somewhere, a vein blew up. So we're going to start with our digestive system part 2 for the cat. So we're going to start with the pancreas. So what we need to do is actually find the stomach first and then look underneath the stomach. This pink blobby looking stuff is actually going to be your pancreas. So you can see the pancreas here wrapping around underneath the lovely stomach. You also have a liver, so your liver is this large brown structure here, so we have a large brown liver here. You have a hepatic portal vein. For some reason in this cat, the veins are not blue, I think probably because all the blue dye is everywhere. So what we have left is actually a yellow tube. So your hepatic portal vein is going to be this yellow tube, this large one here, actually coming from the digestive organs and feeding into the liver. So it's this big yellow one here, probably is going to be blue in most of your cats. Also, hiding underneath the liver, you have a little bag. This little bag right here is called the gallbladder, so your gallbladder is here. If we move down now, so this is all small intestine, but if we look at the size difference, remember the large intestine, if I put my thumb on it, is wider than my thumb. Small intestine, skinnier than my thumb. So this is going to be large intestine here. It starts where the small intestine ends. Remember there's the ileocecal valve right here. We actually found that ileocecal valve from the inside. It looks like that right there. So this first part of the large intestine is going to be your cecum. So cecum is here. This is all going to be large intestine or colon, and then once you get to the last region before it leaves the body, basically as poop, you're going to be inside of the rectum. So the rectum is the very last section of the large intestine, well, actually past the large intestine, but it's the very last section right here of the tubing. Now we need to find some arteries. It's a miracle I didn't manage to break any of them, so here we go. This large red artery right here is going to be your superior mesenteric artery. Mesenteric means it basically feeds the mesenteries, so mesenteric artery here. Your inferior mesenteric artery is going to be right here. So superior is more towards the head, inferior is more towards the tail. This very large tube that runs right along the basically the back of the cat, it starts all the way down here in the pelvis, way down here in the pelvis, and it goes all the way up to the heart. It's going to be your aorta, so it's going to be your aorta right here. And next door, the big blue one's going to be the inferior vena cava. Again, it goes all the way to the heart, so inferior vena cava is going to be here. And then the very last artery you guys need to find is the gonadal arteries, and they're little tiny ones, but you can see there's one that runs this way, and there's also one over here that runs this way. So they're kind of, they're above the superior mesenteric, but below, or sorry, they're above the inferior mesenteric, but below the superior mesenteric in the middle. And there's two of them, and they run down to the testes or ovaries, depending if you have a male or female cat. That's it.
See.
All right, cat urinary system, here we go. So this is obviously, we got all the guts out of the way. This is a kidney. Coming up the kidney, you see there's a blue tube right here. That would be the renal vein. And then kind of hiding in the back, you have a red tube, which is going to be your renal artery. Coming off of here, there's a tube that doesn't have a color. This is going to be a ureter. And then obviously the urine's made in the kidneys. It travels down the ureter. And it goes to this little bag right here. This would be your urinary bladder. And then coming off the bladder, when you actually go pee, this last little tube is going to be the urethra. So urethra, urinary bladder, ureter, kidney, renal arteries, the red one, renal veins, the blue one. That's all she wrote.
Start.
All right, so this is going to be the sheep kidney. Obviously, it's a lot bigger than a cat kidney. So the thing on the outside is going to be the renal capsule. So this is your renal capsule on the outside. Again, over here, too, renal capsule. If we actually open it up, though, and look on the inside, you can see that there's a lighter shaded brown area here before you get into this darker brown. This outer layer here, from here to here, that wraps around the outside is going to be the cortex of the kidney, whereas this darker region with all this fun stuff in it is going to be the medulla. So it goes medulla on the inside, medulla in the middle, and cortex on the outside with the capsule surrounding the entire thing. Inside of our medulla, we have a couple of different structures. So on this one, you can actually see a pretty nice one. This little sort of triangular shape, let's use our imaginations, thing is called the renal pyramid. And in between the pyramid, you have a darker little kind of shade of brown that kind of looks like this same stuff here. This is going to be a column. So it goes pyramid, column, all the way around, wrapping around. You can see some of them in here, but not exactly all of them. Once you make the urine out here, basically at the border between the cortex and the medulla, it drains across the pyramid and it gets dumped into a structure called a minor calyx, a very small little piece of tubing, which then jumps into a more major calyx, which I don't know how they even labeled them on here because I'm not sure, guys, to be completely honest.
Right?
Oh, like a little bit, but not really. So I guess they'd maybe label minor calyx out here, major calyx down here, where it starts to drain into a single tube. But again, you might want to ask on that one because I'm not really sure. We never labeled them before. But then once you actually leave the kidney and get into a single tube, this tube is called the ureter. So on these guys, really all you can see is the capsule on the outside. And then if you look inside of all this fat material, there's actually the ureter on the inside. So you can kind of see, this one doesn't even have the ureter. But you can see the ureter coming out this way from this guy. That's it.
Action.
Alright guys, so now we're going to exam number 3, digestive system 2. So the pancreas is first. The pancreas is this structure right here. The head of the pancreas is this kind of enlarged area right here, whereas the body is the majority of it, and then the tail is obviously the tail. The main pancreatic duct is the main white tube that runs down the center. Then the accessory ducts are going to be the little guys that come off the sides, little accessory ducts coming off the sides. The duodenal papillae is going to be that little nub that sticks into the inside of the small intestine. It's where basically the fluid from the pancreas and from the liver drain into. And then right before that, where these two guys join together, is going to be the duodenal ampulla. So there's a little space where the two fluids kind of mix. The duodenal ampulla is here. And then surrounding it, basically this red here and red here, is going to be a sphincter, the hepatopancreatic sphincter. Hepatic means liver. Pancreas, pancreatic, so hepatopancreatic sphincter is here, opens and closes this little tube so it can either let fluid into the small intestine or not. That's it. And the same thing on that one, it's basically the same thing. Again, pancreas is from a different model, so you still have the head, you still have the body, you still have the tail, you still have the main pancreatic duct, which is the big one, you still have the accessory ducts coming off the side. As far as the papilla goes, you can see here there's just kind of a little nub, so this would be your duodenal papilla in here. You really can't see the ampulla, it's hidden underneath here. And you can't see the sphincter either, so. Mm-hmm. Alright, so we're starting off with the big liver. So first of all, you have to figure out how this actually sits inside of your body. And believe it or not, if I put this inside of myself, it sits like this. So they have the base sticking straight out in front of you. So that means that this is going to be your right lobe of your liver. This is going to be the left lobe of your liver. So put it inside you with the base sticking out, and that's it's in anatomical position. So the right lobe is a lot bigger. So this is going to be your right lobe. This is going to be your left lobe. This is going to be your quadrate lobe because it's got four sides. And then your caudate lobe is going to be this one right here. And I think you need to know all those you do. Okay. The falciform ligament is, I don't know if it's on here. I don't really think it is. So don't worry about the falciform ligament. I don't think so. I mean, it separates the right and the left, but I don't. I guess they'd have to label it as this kind of brown chunk. So this is going to be your falciform ligament. Basically what it does is separates the right lobe from the left lobe, but it's really not defined on here, but I guess they could label it as that. Moving
ask
along.
Your teacher.
Yeah, right. Ask your teacher. Ask your teacher about a bunch of these ligaments. I never labeled ligaments on here. The porta hepatis is basically where it's going to be this guy right here, where the things go in and out of the liver. So the porta hepatis is going to be the entryway to the liver where things come in and out. The hepatic portal vein is going to be the actual vein here. So the pannhead portus is where all this stuff comes in and out, everything coming in and out of the liver. Kind of like the hilum of a kidney or the hilum of a lung. Porta hepatis is just the doorway to the liver where everything comes in and out. This specific tube is going to be your hepatic portal vein. This one here, this bluish colored pinky one, whatever you want to call it, bluishy white. And then the hepatic artery is going to be the red ones. So the hepatic arteries are going to be the ones that are in red. You might want to ask about the round ligament in the coronary ligament skin. I'm not really sure where they labeled those. All right, so on a different liver, what do we got? So again, this is the same thing. Right lobe, left lobe. I guess you'd call this your falciform ligament. They might also call this the falciform ligament. I'm not really sure. You can see a little bit of the the caudate lobe here. You can't really see the quadrate that great. It's right here. It's this four-shaped one here. So quadrate, caudate, left, right, potentially falciform ligament here. And that's really all I would label on that, other than the hepatic artery, which is going to be the red one, and then the hepatic portal vein, which is going to be this purpley one, and then the porta hepatis is where everything is coming in and out of the liver. So that's it for that model. And just again, a couple more. Again, right lobe, left lobe, maybe falciform ligament there or here. Again, you have your quadrate lobe, your caudate lobe, you have your hepatic artery, your hepatic portal vein, your porta hepatis is this entire region. And then this one, right lobe, left lobe, falciform ligament, maybe here or here. Quadrate, caudate, porta hepatis, hepatic artery, hepatic portal vein. Okay, that's it for liver. All right, so the gallbladder is green. So the gallbladder, what you basically need to do is be able to identify it. It's green on all the models, green, 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 and also green, all right? So now you need to be able to recognize the ducts. Remember, the right lobe is the bigger lobe, so the duct that comes off of the right lobe is gonna be the right hepatic duct, whereas this is the left lobe, so this is gonna be the left hepatic duct. They're gonna feed together. Actually, you can see it down here too. So this can be your right hepatic duct, left hepatic duct, they feed together, they join and form a common hepatic duct. So that's gonna be this little chunk here. So you got your right side, your left side, your common hepatic's right here in the middle. The cystic duct is this duct that actually connects to the actual gallbladder itself. So this little duct here is gonna be your cystic duct. When the cystic duct joins a common hepatic duct, there's gonna be a tube that comes off here and actually comes straight at you. That would be the common bile duct. So that's gonna be the one that you don't really actually see. If you labeled it right here, it'd be the one place you could actually label it. The hepatopancreatic sphincter and the duodenal ampulla we already talked about on this model. Remember, the hepatopancreatic sphincter is the sphincter that's around the, basically where the duodenal papillae, the little tube sticks in. So it'd be the sphincter right here. Hepatopancreatic sphincter would be here. Duodenal ampulla is where these two little fluids kind of join together from the pancreas and from the liver. So right about there. And that's it for the gallbladder. All right, guys, so now we're gonna move on to the large intestine. Obviously, this is the small intestine, but this larger tube on the outside is gonna be your large intestine. So we're gonna start at the beginning. This little finger-shaped projection, which is right here, is gonna be your viriform appendix, or just plain old appendix. But viriform appendix is the correct name. This, obviously, is the end of your small intestine. This is gonna be your ileum, and it joins up with the cecum, the first part of the large intestine. This little region right here that's squished together is gonna be your ileocecal valve. So ileocecal valve is here. Once you get past the cecum, you start, think about the direction that the poop is moving, okay? That's the easiest way to think of it. The poop's gonna go up the tube, up the ascending colon. So up the ascending colon here. It's gonna make a little turn. It's gonna make a turn right next to the liver. If you know the word for liver, you know the name of the turn, hepatic. So this is the hepatic flexure or the right colic flexure. You can call it either one. I call it hepatic, it's just me. Then the poop goes across the transverse colon. It goes around another corner. If you know what sits right here, it's your spleen. So guess what this is called? It's called the splenic flexure or the left colic flexure. We then go down the descending colon here. And once we get to right about here, it actually wraps up underneath itself and makes a big S underneath the small intestine. So it actually goes up and around like a big S in the sigmoid colon before it enters what we call the rectum. So this is your rectum here. Inside the rectum, you have anal columns, which are these little kind of stripes, number 37, whatever you want to call it. And then surrounding the rectum, there's an inner layer of muscle called the internal anal sphincter. So this is your internal anal sphincter, which happens to be involuntary muscle, smooth muscle. And then outside of it, a little bit further out, you have external anal sphincter, which is skeletal muscle, so you don't poop your pants. All right, the actual hole itself is called the anus. And then a couple of other things you need to know about these little kind of ball, like bulges in the large intestine, these little kind of, I don't know how you call them, bumps, lumps, are gonna be called hostra. This white kind of cord that runs along the inside is called the tenae coli. And then these little kind of blobs here are actually little blobs of fat called fatty appendages. So fatty appendages. Same thing on a different model. Again, small intestine, large intestine is shown in brown. So small intestine's here. At the end, we can actually take the small intestine out. Ileocecal valve, this is the cecum, the ascending colon, the hepatic flexure, transverse colon, splenic flexure, descending colon. Then you can see, now you can see the S for the sigmoid colon here, but there's no rectum on this one, so you can't see any of the parts that are past that. Again, you can see the individual hostra, these are the little lumps parts. You can see the tenae coli, which is the white cord, and you can see the epiploic or fatty appendages, which are shown in yellow. They're supposed to prevent fat blobs. This one, again, small intestine. Ooh, hang on a second. Small intestine, large intestine shown in gray. We need the small intestine out of the way. Ileocecal valve is here. This is the cecum. This is your viriform appendix. Oh, I don't think you have an appendix on that one. Oh, you do. Sorry, on this one there's also an appendix. So don't forget about the little appendix, the little viriform appendix. Again, so viriform appendix, the cecum. The ascending colon goes up. The hepatic flexure, transverse colon goes across. Splenic flexure, descending colon goes down. The sigmoid colon, where you can see it goes, kind of wraps up and around itself. Sigmoid colon into the rectum, which would be this last tube here. Again, you can't see the internal stuff or the sphincters on these ones, but that's what that is. You can still see the hostra, which would be these little gray areas, but you really can't see the fatty appendages either. So, and then the tenae coli would be this white line. And that's it for large intestine. Here we go. Ready?
Mm-hmm.
So now we're still going to be in exam 3, but now we're going to do blood vessels. So the abdominal aorta is the big red one. The inferior vena cava would be the big blue one. Coming off of the abdominal aorta, we have this little guy here that actually branches in 3 different directions. So 1, 2, 3. He's called the celiac trunk. So that's your celiac trunk there. The next big red one that's right here that's coming off is going to be your superior mesenteric artery. And then the one that's dead center that's below that is going to be the inferior mesenteric artery. And I believe that they're calling this one over here a gonadal artery, this one that's coming off to the side. So that's the arteries. As far as veins go, again, the blue one is the inferior vena cava. I think this might be what they're calling the inferior mesenteric vein, but I'm not positive on that one. And then the superior mesenteric, I'm not really sure. It might be this big one here. And then this one is going to be your hepatic portal vein. It's going to go to your liver. So, okay, that's it. On this guy, again, the big red one's going to be the aorta. The big blue one's going to be the inferior vena cava. The inferior phrenic artery is going to be this red one that actually goes up to the diaphragm. So phrenic means diaphragm. So this red one that goes upwards is going to be the inferior phrenic. The celiac trunk is still going to be this one where you have the 3 branches coming off. So celiac trunk is still going to be here. This one that's actually missing is going to be the superior mesenteric artery. And then this one down here would be your inferior mesenteric artery. I don't think there's a gonadal one on there. Hepatic portal. This is really not great. No, this is the liver, so I'm assuming it's going to be the one that's just going to the liver. This kind of big collection of blood vessels that are blue, they're going into the liver, would be your hepatic portal vein. Inferior mesenteric, superior mesenteric, I don't think any of those are even on there, so that's all you got for blood vessels. Sorry, guys. All right, so now we're going to start the urinary system for exam 3, so just a couple you need to be able to find in here. Again, you need to be able to find the celiac trunk, which is going to be this red one that splits into 3 pieces. You also need to be able to find a renal artery, which is going to be the red one, and the renal vein, which is going to be the blue one. The renal means going to the kidneys. All right, this guy, same story. So the celiac trunk is still the one that has 3 different branches, but now you're going to need to see the renal artery here, and then the renal vein is going to be in blue. Good, good, good. Now over here, so the actual models of the urinary system. Aorta, inferior vena cava, renal vein, and then the renal artery, if we flip it around, renal artery, okay? Same thing here, aorta, inferior vena cava, renal artery, renal artery, renal vein. Very, very simple. Those ones are very simple. All right, the next thing we need to be able to find on the actual, let's see. Obviously these are kidneys, so kidney, 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 and this is a big picture of a kidney. There's also some smaller versions of kidneys, but just for now. The tube's coming off. This is actually supposed to represent a ureter. It's supposed to be attached. There should be another one on the other side. So this is a ureter. This is also a ureter here. And then coming off of this one, this guy would be your ureter right here. Once you get off the end of the ureter, this structure right here, this is not a weird bird, this is actually your bladder. So your bladder, and then this bladder is falling apart, so we'll just kind of quickly put it back together. And it should be chilling in here, like so, I believe, somewhere in there. It goes in there, whatever, it goes like this. I just don't want to spend time putting it back together right now. Bladder, bladder, bladder. And then off the bladder, you'd actually have your urethra, but you need to actually open the bladder up to see a little bit of the urethra right here. So this is going to be a little bit of the urethra in a male. So this can be what we call prostatic urethra. This is a little bit of your urethra right about there. You can't see any of those parts further down. So stop there for now. All right, so now we're going to start the urinary system for exam 3. So just a couple you need to be able to find in here. Again, you need to be able to find the celiac trunk, which is going to be this red one that splits into three pieces. You also need to be able to find a renal artery, which is going to be the red one, and the renal vein, which is going to be the blue one. The renal means going to the kidneys. All right, this guy, same story. So the celiac trunk is still the one that has three different branches, but now you need to see the renal artery here, and then the renal vein is going to be in blue. Good, good, good. Now over here, so the actual models of the urinary system. Aorta, inferior vena cava, renal vein, and then the renal artery, if we flip it around, renal artery, okay? Same thing here, aorta, inferior vena cava, renal artery, renal vein, renal artery, renal vein. Very, very simple, those ones are very simple. All right, the next thing we need to be able to find on the actual, let's see, obviously these are kidneys, so kidney, 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 and this is a big picture of a kidney. There's also some smaller versions of kidneys, but just for now. The tube's coming off. This is actually supposed to represent a ureter. It's supposed to be attached. There should be another one on the other side. So this is a ureter. This is also a ureter here. And then coming off of this one, this guy would be your ureter right here. Once you get off the end of the ureter, this structure right here, this is not a weird bird. This is actually your bladder. So your bladder, and then this bladder is falling apart. So we'll just kind of quickly put it back together. And it should be chilling in here. Like so, I believe. Somewhere in there. It goes in there. Whatever. It goes like this. I just don't want to spend time putting it back together right now. Bladder, bladder, bladder. And then off the bladder, you'd actually have your urethra, but you need to actually open the bladder up to see a little bit of the urethra right here. So this is going to be a little bit of the urethra in a male. So this can be what we call prostatic urethra. This is a little bit of your urethra right about there. You can't see any of those parts further down. So stop there for now. All right, so now we're going to move into the actual kidney. So on your list, it says superior pole and inferior pole. I'm not really sure what those are. Maybe the superior portion, which would be up top, and inferior pole would be down here. That's where we're going to guess with. But the part, other than that, I know the rest of the parts. On the outside of the kidney, you have the renal capsule. So this is going to be the capsule on the outside, just like you saw in the sheep. And again, we have some other kidneys here. Renal capsule, and then on this flat one, also renal capsule. All right, if we look inside the kidney now. So I'm going to look at it just on this one for now. This region out here is going to be your cortex, and then all this stuff on the inside is going to be the medulla. In the actual medulla itself, we have these little triangular-shaped pink regions. These are called renal pyramids. So this is a renal pyramid, and in between them where the blood vessels are running is called a renal column. So these are actually going to be renal columns. There's a renal column right here too. Moving along, at the tips of the renal pyramids right here, it's called a renal papilla, so it's just the tips of the pyramid that kind of lead into these little tubes. And these little tubes, this little tube right here, is called a minor calyx. So you have your renal pyramid with the renal papilla, the little papilla here, draining into a minor calyx. These little minor calyces join together to form a larger major calyx. So you can see three little minor calyxes here form one major calyx right here. The major calyx then join together to form a renal pelvis, which then turns into a tube, which we call the ureter. I think that's it. So it's just the same stuff on this one. Again, the cortex is out here, the medulla is in here. These are your pyramids with the papilla, the minor calyxes joining to form major calyxes, joining to form a renal pelvis, joining to form a ureter. This is a really crappy one, but just in case they give it to you, I want you guys to know. The cortex is out here, the medulla, the renal pyramids, the renal columns are in between. The minor calyxes are here. They join together to form a major calyx here and here. It forms a single renal pelvis heel that's turned into a ureter. This is a really bad model. And then the nicest one that we probably have, which you guys probably will definitely have on the practical, is going to be this guy. Again, the renal capsule is going to be out here. The cortex is going to be this outer region here. This is all medulla. You have your renal pyramids, which are these kind of darker red with the points. These are the little papilla right here, renal papilla. They drain into the minor calyces, or minor calyx. The minor calyx join together to form major calyx, which join to form a single renal pelvis, which then turns into a ureter. Sounds good. So that's the big picture over here. Again, you can see in the renal artery and you can see the renal vein. They split into smaller and smaller arteries and veins as you go into the actual kidney. Now, if we take this little section right here and we zoom in on it, this is what we see. So this is zoomed in. So this is going to show you the nephron. So the nephron is basically where you're going to actually be making your urine. So what happens is the blood comes up all these little arteries and it feeds into these little Christmas tree bulbs via these little tiny red arteries here. And these little tiny red arteries are called afferent arterioles. So if they're feeding into the Christmas bulb coming off the big tree stem, basically, that's an afferent arteriole. This structure here is called a renal corpuscle. Renal corpuscle. And if we zoom in on one of these Christmas tree bulbs, just one of them, it looks like this. This is backwards. This is one of those little bulbs if you zoomed way in on it. So this is one renal corpuscle if you put tape across the whole thing. But it has a couple of parts that make up a single corpuscle. This ball of capillaries, this actually ball of wadded up mess, is called a glomerulus. So this is your glomerulus. It sits inside of a cup. This cup is called the Bowman's capsule. So the Bowman's capsule plus the glomerulus equals one renal corpuscle. At the top you can see the blood vessel. So this is the blood vessel feeding into the glomerulus, and it's bigger and fatter around than this one. This one's actually skinnier. If you actually measure the diameter around, it's skinnier. The bigger, fatter one is the afferent arterioli with an A. The one that's leading or exiting, leaving the glomerulus, is going to be the efferent arterioli with an E. Okay, efferent arterioli is smaller, efferent arterioli is larger. Okay, so now we need to go back to the middle one. So we're done with our renal corpuscle. We know what it looks like now that we've zoomed in on it. This is it when we zoom back out. So from our renal corpuscle, the blood comes into the glomerulus. We form this stuff called filtrate that then fills the Bowman's capsule. It then starts to drain out of our renal corpuscle. It goes into this first wadded up set of tubing. This first wadded up set of tubing is called a proximal convoluted tubule. Proximal because it's close to the renal corpuscle, and convoluted just means twisted. So proximal convoluted tubule, it then travels down a structure called the loop, the nephron loop. This is the descending limb of the loop of Henle. And this is the ascending limb of the loop of Henle. We then come up on another wadded up mess of tubing called the distal convoluted tubule. And from there, the actual, what's almost urine now, dumps into this big tree with no branches called the collecting duct, which then takes it down, down, down. We go back over here. We're going across this pyramid. We're going down, down, down. The urine gets dumped into the minor calyx, into the major calyx, into the renal pelvis, and then out the ureter. Okay? Stop. Okay, so now guys, we're gonna go to the urinary bladder. So this is the bladder here, or this is the bladder here. You only have two models of the bladder. Oh, but you can see bladders on these ones as well. So if we look at the male and female, this is the bladder on the male, and then this is the bladder on the female, just so you guys are aware. So if you look here, this is a bladder in a female, and then over here, the bladder in the male, okay? All right, so back to the actual bladder. So if we open the bladder up, all the stuff we need to be able to see on the inside. So remember, these little ureters drain down and they empty into these tubes here. So the actual opening where they open up into the inside of the bladder, this little spot right here, there's one on each side. There's one on this side, there's one on this side. See how there's two? These little guys have names. We're calling them ureteral orifices, okay, or slits. So ureteral or urethral, not urethral, ureteral orifices. I cannot say that word ever, okay? If you look between where these little orifices or slits are, and then there's the opening down here to the urethra, there's this very smooth, flat spot, and if you actually put the pieces together, it looks kind of like a triangle. This is called the trigone. So this smooth, flat spot's gonna be called the trigone. We move a little bit further down, right at the base of the bladder. So basically right here, they have this little purple line. This little purple line is actually a sphincter. So it's gonna be your internal urethral sphincter. It's a smooth muscle, so it's involuntary, so you don't, or smooth muscle, so it's involuntary. So the internal urethral sphincter is here, whereas the external urethral sphincter we need to see over here. So your internal urethral sphincter would be up here, right at the base of the bladder. So right here, at this little white line basically would be your internal urethral sphincter. The secondary one, which is the external sphincter, is actually going to be down here in the pelvic floor. So it's going to be your external urethral sphincter down here. This is going to be the voluntary one, so you don't pee your pants. Okay? All right. And then the last but not least is just going to be the urethra. So urethra is going to be shown here. But if we look on the models of the male and female, you can see the urethra actually goes all the way down the end of the penis inside of guys. And then for ladies, it goes right down here. So this is going to be your urethra right here coming off your bladder. And that is it.
Thank you.
Okay, so a couple that we forgot for the urinary system. So this is actually just a zoomed in renal corpuscle. So this is the renal corpuscle. Remember, it makes up a couple parts. So this is your glomerulus on the inside, the Bowman's capsule on the outside. Renal corpuscle as a whole. Remember, the afferent arterioli is bigger around, so this is your afferent arterioli here, your efferent arterioli here. This would be the beginning of your proximal convoluted tubule. That's it for this one. This one is just one zoomed in nephron. Well, it's actually a couple of three zoomed in nephrons. We're just gonna look at one. So remember, the blood comes up, it enters the renal corpuscle, which is the little Christmas tree bulb, and then it actually leaves via the efferent arterioli here, the blood leaves, and goes into these paratubular capillaries, and ends up going back into the veins and going back to the heart. But we produce this stuff called filtrate here in our renal corpuscle. The first thing it does is it goes into a bunch of tubing, this lighter brown colored tubing. This is the proximal convoluted tubule. It then goes down the descending limb of the loop of Henle. Then it goes up the ascending limb of the loop of Henle to the distal convoluted tubule, shown here in dark purple. Then it then drains into the collecting duct down here. Do-do-do-do-do, out it goes. That's it. I'm gonna show you this one. All right. Here we go. So this is going to be exam 3, female reproductive system. So we're going to start in the ovary. Obviously, this is the ovary here. couple of things you need to be able to find. So the mature tertiary follicle is going to be this entire structure here. So this is a mature tertiary follicle, the whole thing, I guess. The secondary oocyte is just going to be the little tiny guy inside the circle. And actually this big huge space is called the antrum. So it's kind of like a big bubble that kind of bursts and release the oocyte when it goes down into the actual fallopian tube. All right, so a uterine tubes, this is the same thing as a fallopian tube, so it's gonna be all this tubing that connects eventually to the lovely uterus. So there's a couple of different parts. If you actually look at the back of this model, like a little bit to the side, you can see there's these little projections that are kind of wrapping around the ovary. Those are like little fingers, they're called fimbriae. So these are gonna be your little fimbriae here. Where the fimbriae connect and attach in this little spot here is gonna be called the infundibulum. The infundibulum then turns into this region here called the ampulla. And then the ampulla turns into the isthmus, which is all the rest of this kind of tubing that make up the uterine tube. You can also see that on these guys, I think, a little bit. So again, the fimbriae are going to be these little extensions that kind of wrap around. This is the ovary, this little egg. The fimbriae are here. When they join together, they form the infundibulum. So think about the fimbriae as the fingers. The infundibulum is like the hand. And then after that, you get to the wrist. The wrist is going to be the ampulla. And then the rest of the arm is going to be your isthmus. So the arm is the isthmus. The ampulla is the wrist. The infundibulum is the hand, and the fingers are the fimbriae. That's the easiest way to remember it. At least that's how I remember it. Okay, if we move along, parts on our lovely uterus. So this is the uterus here. We have a fundus. Remember in the stomach, it was the upper dome part. Well, it's the same thing here. So this upper dome is called the fundus of the uterus. The body is the vast majority of the uterus. The uterine cavity is the actual space inside the uterus. Here, this structure that's actually the end of the uterus, and there's the border between the uterus and the vagina. This is called your cervix. And the hole inside of your cervix is called the external cervical os. On here, you don't see the broad ligament, but you do see the round ligament. So the round ligament attaches the ovary to the actual uterus itself, so it doesn't flop around. This would be the beginning of your vagina, your vaginal canal here. It's after the cervix. So that's all we can see on this model. So if we want to go to this one now. We already talked about the ovary. We already talked about the parts of the fallopian tube. This is going to be the actual uterus itself, and the rest of it's going to be here. The uterus sits on top of the bladder. So obviously, when you're a pregnant lady, the baby starts to fill up the space, pushes on your bladder to pee all the time. So this is going to be your uterus up here. This would be your uterine cavity, the space inside. So you can see it over here too. The space inside is the uterine cavity. This little structure here, that's the end of the uterus, is going to be your cervix, and that little tiny hole is going to be the external cervical os. So you can see them there. Again, you can see the cervix labeled 24, and the little os would be the little hole right here at the end. The rest of the structure moving down is going to be the vagina, so you can see it here, and you can also see it here, so it's all going to be vagina. Really, the butt, like the fundus and all that good stuff, this is the fundus here, so you can see a little bit of the fundus here and a little bit of the fundus here. So when you put these parts back together, if we actually look at it, if we hold it up, you can see the upper dome part, right? So this upper dome-shaped part that's above where the actual fallopian tubes come out is going to be your fundus here. The rest is obviously just going to be the body. You can see the round ligament still, so you can see the round ligament here attaching the ovary to the uterus here. And now you have this big wide ligament here, this is called the broad ligament, that's shown kind of in this yellow color, that kind of basically holds the uterus in place on both sides of it. So there'd actually be one coming straight towards you too as well. So that's going to be your broad ligament. Now we need to move into the actual inside, so this is going to be our vagina. On the outside of the body, what can you see from the outside? The external genitalia. We have the mons pubis, which is this big fat pad in the front of the pubic bone. So this can be your mons pubis here. You have an outer labia majora and then an inner labia minora. You also have a couple of holes. So your external urethral meatus is going to be the actual pee hole. So when you comes down your urethra, the little actual hole that you can see from the outside is the external urethral meatus. The clitoris is going to be up here. It's going to be labeled number 20. And then the vaginal entrance is obviously the entrance to the vagina. It's going to be this area right here. So that's it for ladies. Now we just need to see the boob. We have a boob. Here it is. All right. So there's not that many parts to a boob. There's the pectoral fat pad, which is going to be shown here in yellow. The nipple, which is the center. I think you guys know what nipples are. Surrounding the nipple, you have the areola, which is usually a different color than the rest of the skin on the breast. And then the mammary glands, which are going to be these purple little guys here that actually produce the milk. So that's going to be it. That's it for boobs. That's it for ladies. Okay. Hang on. Let me just get this sitting in the right spot. Okay.
Not right.
Get in your home. Okay. Okay. So now we're going to do... Are we ready? Doing the male reproductive system again for exam number 3. So the scrotum itself is going to be this sack of skin that actually holds the testy. The testy is going to be this guy shown here on the inside. Moving along, we're going to skip the parts of the sperm for now, so we're just going to move into the rest of the parts of the male reproductive system. This region up here that kind of wraps up around the testes is called the epididymis, so this is going to be our epididymis here. If we took a piece of tape and wrapped it around not just this pink cord, but also the red and the blue, which are arteries and veins and nerves, we took tape, wrapped it around the whole thing, that would be called a spermatic cord. So the spermatic cord contains not only the pink cord, but also arteries, veins, and nerves, so spermatic cord. Just the pink cord by itself is called the vas deferens or the ductus deferens, and it wraps all the way up and around the bladder and goes towards the actual back of the bladder. At the back end of our vas deferens or ductus deferens, it gets a little bit fatter in the region called the ampulla of the vas deferens. And now if we actually open it up and look on the inside, remember this is the bladder here. Look on the inside, where the actual tube comes around and joins to the back, it actually comes in right here. So this is going to be our ejaculatory duct. This is this little section of tubing right inside here. So ejaculatory duct is here. Now if we put this back on, sort of, because I can never get the freaking thing to go on the model, because it hates me, okay? This is our vas deferens or ductus deferens here. If we look in the back side, so this is going to be our little ampulla. This structure right here is called a seminal vesicle, so this is going to produce some of the fluid that's found in the sperm, so seminal vesicle is here. Again, it's also going to dump into the ejaculatory duct, this little part right here. The prostate is this pink ball here, so you can see the prostate from this side, and you can also see it from in here, though. This pink thing is going to be your prostate. The urogenital diaphragm is actually going to be the pelvic floor, so the floor of your pelvis. So this little sheet of muscle that covers basically the whole bottom of your pelvis is going to be your urogenital diaphragm. And if you look inside your urogenital diaphragm, there's a little region right here and a little region right here. It's kind of like a little bit bluishy, reddish color. That's actually supposed to represent a gland. It's called a bulbourethral gland. So there's bulbourethral glands on either side of your urethra inside your urogenital diaphragm. The urethra itself is this big long tube that comes all the way down and goes all the way out to the end of the penis. It has a couple of different names in guys because it's so long and it goes through so many different structures. So the part of the urethra that's inside the prostate, this little region of it right here, is going to be called the prostatic urethra. The little piece of it that goes through the urogenital diaphragm is going to be the membranous urethra, and all the rest is going to be called the penile urethra or the spongy urethra, depending on who you're talking to. Now the penis itself, we're going to put this back on if we can, without it being a pain in my, you know what, okay? So the penis itself, you guys have seen penises probably. This is the penis. This is the body or the shaft of the penis. This enlarged end is going to be the glans penis. The hole at the end where the urine comes out is going to be the external urethral orifice or external urethral meatus. And then if we actually open up and look on the inside, the last two things you need to be able to find are the erectile tissue when you get, basically when you get an erection. So these guys are going to fill up with blood. So this is going to be your corpus cavernosum, which is going to be the one in purple. And then your corpus spongiosum around your spongy urethra is going to be the one shown in red. So corpus spongiosum. That is all. You're welcome. Have a great life. Wait, that's not all. I lied. Okay, be careful. Edit that out. All right. Last but not least, the very last model ever is going to be the model of the sperm. Sperm are very, very easy. So what we really care about is this one. These are the developing sperm, but the mature sperm is what we care about. So the head of the sperm is going to be this brown area here. This little section right here is going to be the neck of the sperm. This is going to be what we call the midpiece, which has lots of blue little balls called mitochondria. These are supposed to represent mitochondria. Inside the midpiece. And then the rest of it's all going to be tail. Inside the head of our sperm, we have this tip region right here, which is called the acrosome or acrosomal cap. It's got enzymes so it can eat through the egg when it butts up with the egg. And then the last thing you need to see right here is going to be the nucleus, which is number 5 on the model. Now it's the end. Good job.